Today, all over the world, we are gathering. In large groups and small. In different places and different languages. In buildings and schools. Empty spaces and open fields. In our homes and on our phones. Some come together in freedom, while others have to meet in secret. Some will sing the old hymns, while others are singing something new. We'll all learn different things from the same Bible and worship the same God in different ways. We are the church, the body of Christ, different pieces molded together by the hand of God. Today, all over the world, we are gathering as one.
Amen. Well, happy Super Bowl Sunday to everybody. How many of y'all are wearing your team colors or your jersey? Raise your hand this morning. You are showing where you are a fan of. How many, let me just ask, how many Georgia fans do we have in the house this morning? Make some noise. Georgia fans. Georgia Tech, you never get any love. Georgia Tech fans in the house, where are you at? I hear you. Any Atlanta Falcons fans in here that you want to admit you're a Falcons fan? Anybody? There we go. We got a few. Got a few still want to admit it. Any Braves fans in the house? Make some noise. There we go. Let's see, I've seen some Alabama fans. Any Alabama fans in the house? You're a lot braver than I am. Thank you, guys. Thank y'all for supporting. I try to be a peacemaker. I don't want anybody walking out on me this morning wearing an Alabama jersey, so I'm proud of you guys for supporting the team. Let's see, are there anybody wearing any NASCAR? Anybody NASCAR in here? Any soccer? Any soccer fans? I saw some soccer up on the stage. I see ya. Any pickleball? Any pickleball fans? I know we got a pickleball league up in here. Let's go. Good to see everybody. We're so glad that you're here. Thank you. We want to have a good time in church. I've heard a pastor say before that the church ought to have more fun going to heaven than the world going to hell. Can I get an amen? And so we want to have a good time in church. We want to enjoy church. We want our kids to enjoy church. Why? Because God gives us joy, and we believe that Jesus is the joy of our life. See, when it comes to Super Bowl Sunday, and by the way, how many of y'all think the Chiefs are going to win today? Raise your hand. The Chiefs are going to win today. Let me see you. How many of y'all think the 49ers are going to win today? 49ers? How many of y'all think Taylor Swift is going to win today? She's going to win. That's what I thought. That's what I thought. All you Swifties in the house. It's so important, you know, when we wear our team gear, right? Our team gear, sometimes it's even hard to tell who someone cheers for, who someone roots for just by their team colors, because so many teams share the same color combination. But when you have a team logo, when you have a team brand that you wear, then you know who they go for, or you show them who you go for. But sometimes there's some confusion. Isn't it funny? Sometimes there's confusion between the Atlanta Braves A and the Alabama A. You ever noticed that before? Has that ever got on your nerves? You Braves fan, you're like, oh, are you a Bama fan? No, I'm a Braves fan. Well, how do you know? The Alabama has a mullet. The Alabama A has a mullet. Do you see that? There's no mullet on the Brave. There's a mullet on the Alabama. I'm from Alabama, and we resemble that remark, okay? I don't. They do. Okay, there we go. The mullet on the Bama. Well, we believe that that logo, that branding is so important when it comes to sports teams because it's an identity marker. And it just so happened, just a couple of months ago, I went to our creative director, Jenny Highsmith. Put your hands together for Jenny. She does such a great job. And with everything that she does for us, and I said, Jenny, if we ever, like in years to come, wanted to change our church logo, if we ever wanted to change our church look, our church brand, what do you think you would come up with? And she was like, well, I'll think about it. She came back in like two days, and she said, well, here's something that I drew up, and I just thought maybe this was a good idea, and I looked at it, and don't put it on the screen yet, please. And I said, Jenny, that is incredible. So I took it to our staff, and they loved it. I took it to our deacons, and they loved it. I took it to some of you that maybe just in conversation and passing, and you loved it. And so we thought, man, this is something that we believe the Lord is calling us to do, and we just want to follow Jesus. And so I want to show you that church logo this morning. Can I do that? Can I get a drum roll, please? Drum roll during this time. Drum roll. Here we go. Just a little suspense. Now, before I show it to you, I want you to know, I want you to see a couple of things. You're going to see some rolling hills like Georgia. You're going to see a spring because we're Powder Springs. You'll see a cross because we believe that Jesus is always front and center. Can I get an amen? All right, drum roll. Here we go. Drum roll. Drum roll. But hold on a second. Hold on. But before I show it to you, there's some really warm and inviting colors because we want people to feel warm and welcome. Okay, drum roll, please. Drum roll. Drum roll. One more thing, real quick. So when you see the logo, I want you to erupt in applause. We're going to show a video for you. Can you promise to do that? Is that good? Here we go. Drum roll. Check it out. Watch this video. Check it out. I want to show it to you right now. The suspense is building. Church logo. Isn't that awesome? You do a great job. You see those rolling hills around Georgia. You see the spring that is leading to and from the cross. Don't we believe that everything leads to and flows from the cross? Can I get an amen? You see those warm colors up there. And so we are so excited and we're just so thankful for what God is doing in this new season. Everyone say new season. New season that we all get to experience together. But yet you'll also notice as you walk around, there will still be the old logo, which we love. It's like the iPhone app with the cross on it. And we love it. And we just didn't want to do one big stark change because we didn't want to shock anybody. And so we'll do kind of a slow rollout of changing things over time just to kind of enhance it over time. But we did want to give you the opportunity to go ahead and get your hands on the new church logo and some things that you can have in your possession just to kind of show the community who we are. So check this video out and the opportunity that you have today. Check this out. So today you are going to have the opportunity. We'll have a product table over in our Connection Center where you'll be able to buy some different things. We're not making any money off of anything. You'll just pay for what it costs. And you'll be able also to go online to fbcps.org and we'll have /shop and you'll be able to buy stuff there to where you can have some new gear, some new apparel with our new church logo. Put your hands together for all that God is doing. We're so thankful. Man, our staff is incredible. They work so hard on things like this. They work so well together. In fact, next week we're starting a brand new series as we're going to get back into Genesis and finish out Genesis over the next 6 weeks. And we're calling the series Family Matters. Family Matters because we want to talk about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph and all of their family. And we want to talk about our family. Why? Because our family matters. Your family. Family matters. We're a church family, but also we're made up of many different families. And our staff came up with this idea to make this video for you. And because they did such an amazing job, I couldn't wait till next week. I had to show you just a little foretaste of what you'll be able to experience next week with our new video. So check out this video of our new series starting next week.
It's a rare condition this day and age to read any good news on the newspaper page. Love and tradition of the grand design, some people say it's even harder to find. Well, then there must be some magic clue inside these gentle walls. 'Cause all I see is a tower of dreams, real love bursting out of every scene. Tenderness. As days go by, there's room for you
having a little bit too much fun around here. Put your hands together for the staff and what a great job that they do. But hey, I want to tell you this morning, open up your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4. I want to tell you this morning that it is by no means is it about our logo, by no means is it about our church, by no means is it about our name. As we learned last week with the Tower of Babel, we are here to make a name for Jesus. Can I get an amen? Put your hands together for Jesus. We're so thankful for all that he is and all that he does. Our identity is ultimately in him. So as we talk this morning, if I could have a sermon title this morning, it would be One Team. Everybody say One Team. If you could imagine watching the Super Bowl tonight, and if you could imagine the Chiefs, or if you could imagine the 49ers not playing together as one team, if you could imagine maybe one of the quarterbacks calls hike and the offensive line all goes left, but the running back goes right and he just gets creamed, right? Because why? They're not one team together. If you could imagine the quarterback throwing long, but the receiver going short, it's not going to work well because they're called to be one team. In the same way, us as a church, we are called to be one team. We're called to be one team. The Bible calls it one body, one church, all together. We are to share together the same mission, the same vision, the same strategies, the same values. We are to come together as a team, as the one body, the one church of Jesus Christ, and we see it all together in Ephesians 4. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 4, and we'll read through verse 6. The Apostle Paul writes to the church of Ephesus. He says, there is one body. Everybody say one. There is one body. There is one spirit. Everybody say one. There is one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Isn't it amazing that the Apostle Paul, when he is going throughout, talking about all of the most important ones in the Bible, all of the most important ones in life, all the most important ones in Christianity, isn't it important as he talks about one Lord, meaning Jesus, one Spirit, meaning the Holy Spirit, one Father, meaning God, isn't it interesting that he starts out the passage with one body, the church? Thinking about how essential the church is. The church, I want to encourage you, is not just something that we come to. The church is not just something that you go to. The church is not just something that you check off your list during the week. The church is not just something that you come to a spiritual or an enlightening event. The church is not just something that's a part of your Sunday rhythm or routine. The Bible says that the church is the one body of Christ. The church is filled with the Holy Spirit, and the church is the movement that God has chosen to be able to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. So here's what we see from this passage is that we are called to be one team. We're called to be one church together. So here we go. How can you be one team with your church? How can you be one team with our church? Number one, write this down. It starts with this, being filled with the Holy Spirit. Being filled with the Holy Spirit, because here's the deal. Whenever you get filled with the Holy Spirit, you love your church, you love Jesus, you love the things of God all the more, because the Spirit of God changes your desires. The Spirit of God changes your affections, changes what you want. Isn't it interesting in verse 4 that the Apostle Paul said, there is one body and there is one Spirit. The Apostle Paul linked together the church and the Spirit. Why? Because in the New Testament, when Jesus dies, So Jesus dies on the Day of Atonement, the day that they had been celebrating for every time of that year, for all of the years before. Jesus dies on the Day of Atonement. We know that he dies on the third day. He rises from the dead. The Bible tells us after he rises from the dead that he walks on the earth for 40 days. He ascends to heaven, and the Bible says that on the 50th day, which is 10 days later after he ascended, you ever thought about this? On the 50th day is when the Holy Spirit came. So in other words, between day 40 and between day 50, the disciples have got to be thinking, what is going on? Is that it? Is it over? Is it just this now? Is it just us? Like, what is going to happen next? And on day 50, the day of Pentecost, the Bible says that the disciples are all up in an upper room, and the Bible says for the first time in human history that the Holy Spirit falls, the Holy Spirit comes down, the Holy Spirit indwells, the Holy Spirit fills every single believer, everyone who follows Jesus, every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, and at that moment is when God instituted the Church of Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? Which means it's the Spirit of God that makes us the church. It's the Spirit of God that brings us together as one team. It's the Spirit of God that helps us to love Jesus and helps us to love one another. And this is the very heart of Jesus for you. This is exactly what he wants for you. Because the church is the body of Jesus Christ. The church is the bride of Jesus Christ. It's impossible to love Jesus and not love his church. In fact, I've even heard it said, we only love Jesus as much as we love our church. It's the very heart of Jesus. John chapter 17, verse 21. Jesus was praying to his Father for you and for us. And listen to his heart. Jesus prayed that they, meaning his followers, his believers, his disciples, that's us, he prayed that they may be all one, that we may all be one together. Jesus said, just as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, that they also may be in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. In other words, the more that we love one another as a church, the more that we love Jesus as a church, the more that we worship Jesus as a church, the more that we meet together in groups, in community, as a church, the more that we serve one another and we serve our community as a church, the more that we go and we live on mission as one team, as a church, the more the world sees us in it together, the more that they will believe that Jesus has been sent by God the Father. It's amazing. And here's why that's true. Because the world is not just looking for another event to come to. The world is not just looking for a concert to experience. The world is not just looking for a service to be a part of. The world is not dying to find something to do with their Sunday mornings. Have you ever noticed that? But what does the world want? The world wants to be loved. The world wants to belong. Hear me. The world wants to feel safe. The world wants to feel like that they are a part of a life-changing movement. And the only real, true, life-changing movement empowered by the Holy Spirit of God is the Church of Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? In fact, the very word church in Scripture, the Greek word, excuse me while I nerd out for a second, the Greek word is ekklesia. Everyone say ekklesia. You know Greek. Very good. You made it. You're done. You graduated. Ekklesia. Ekklesia. Listen to me. It means called out assembly. In other words, we assemble together. We gather together because we have been called out of the world and we have been called into the Word together. We gather, we worship, we assemble because we've been called out of the world, because we have been called into the Word together. I heard a pastor this week who was talking about a mission trip that he had gone on. It was a mission trip somewhere in a country in Asia. And he was in this country in Asia, and he found a Christian bookstore in Asia. He couldn't believe it. And he went into this Christian bookstore, and the Christian bookstore owner was a believer, was a Christian. And the Christian said, he could tell he was a pastor, they started talking, and he said, I want you to look around my bookstore, and I want you to try to figure out which books are not in my bookstore. The pastor looked around, and he saw Bibles, and he saw Christian self-help books, and he saw theology books and all these different things, and he said, I can't figure it out. And the owner of the Christian bookstore, if you notice, he said, there are no books on the church here in this bookstore. He said, because the government is okay. Our government is okay if you're a Christian. Our government is okay if you believe in Jesus, as long as you're an individual and as long as you don't organize as a church. He said, because when you organize as a church, that's when you, what the government would have seen as a threat. Now listen, we are not called to organize as a threat to our government. Can I get an amen? We're not called to organize as a threat to our community. Can I get an amen? What we all called to organize as for our world, for our country, and for our community is to organize as missionaries. Can I get an amen? We're called to organize together to be able to invite people so that they can learn about Jesus, but also so that we can be empowered and we can go out and we can tell people about Jesus as well. That is why together we must share as one team. We must share one mission together as a church. What is our mission? It's on our website. Our mission is to lead people toward the Savior, Jesus Christ. Everybody say Jesus. We are called to lead people toward our Savior, Jesus, which means we're called to lead people toward the Savior in here as they come, in our groups, as we gather. We're also called to reach people for the Savior when we are out in our community, when we are scattered throughout Cobb and Paulding County, the state of Georgia, our country, or even if you're getting on a plane this week and you're going out of country. We are going wherever you go, you're going with the name of Jesus Christ, and you're going as one team, as our church. So where you are, we are. Where you are, Jesus uses you, Jesus calls you, Jesus employs you. We're also called to one vision. Everybody say vision. And our vision is to reach Cobb County, in Paulding County, in the nations with the gospel of Jesus. What does vision mean? It means that you see it. Do you see it? Do you see that people begin to understand about Jesus because of the witness that we have together? Because of the way that we minister to people, because of the way that we serve people, because of the way that we name drop Jesus, because of the way that we tell our story and our testimony, because of the way that maybe we buy their lunch or we buy their coffee, because of the way that we help them or we serve them in some way, and they say, what makes you different? And you get to talk about Jesus, and you get to talk about His, not our, you get to talk about His church. We have one strategy. Everybody say strategy. We come together as one team. We can do a million things, but God has called us together with one strategy that we get to accomplish, achieve together. That strategy is the way that we worship Jesus together, that we group together in community. Group is so important for a team. It's just like every team that has a team room that they get together and they learn about, here's the plays that we're going to run this week. Listen to me. Church is not just ministry to you. Church is ministry through you. So our church is not just, hey, we have a strategy and how we're going to minister to you. No, we share the strategy with you so that you can minister to others as well. If you believe that, say amen. Man, we believe in worship. We believe in group together. We believe in serving. God has given you a spiritual gift. The Bible says, God has said for you to help upbuild the body of Christ. In other words, if you call First Baptist Church Powder Springs your home, how are you using the gift that God has given you at salvation for the upbuilding of the body of Christ here? Everybody on a football team has a position. I've never seen someone on the sideline with the uniform, with the jersey, and the announcer say, I have no idea what he does. Everybody has a position. Everybody has a role. Everybody has a gift. Everybody has a talent. Everybody has a reason. And you, God has brought you here to be a part of our family, to play your part. And then we all, part of our strategy is our mission together, that we get to organize for the purpose of reaching people for the Savior Jesus Christ as we live on mission, sharing the gospel together, and we all share the same values. Everyone say values. Our values, and you have shared these for a long time, and I love them, that we believe, we grow, we serve, and we love. We believe, we grow, and we serve, and we love. And maybe you're someone here that's new, and we're so thankful that you're here. We're so thankful that God has brought you here and brought you to be a part of us and what God is doing here. And maybe you're wondering, I want to learn more about all of the opportunities here and how I can get more involved, or things that we can do for you as a church, or maybe you want to serve in some way, or maybe you just want to learn more information, or maybe you want to join our church and make our church your church family, your church home. Well, not next Sunday the 18th, but the next Sunday the 25th is going to be what we call our Next Steps Lunch. It's for people that just want more information. It's for people that want to learn more opportunities for you here. It's for people that want to get more involved, or it's for people that want to make as well, that people want to make First Baptist Powder Springs their church home. It's a free lunch with free childcare, and if you are interested, I want to encourage you to register online, because we would love to have you as a part of that lunch on February the 25th. Everyone say the 25th. Very good. Number two, we got to move. You're not listening fast enough. Number two is this. Not only be filled with the Holy Spirit, but number two is be following Jesus as Lord. Be following Jesus as Lord. That's how we're one team. Be following. Notice this is all about God. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be following Jesus as Lord. Here is what he said. Just as you are called to the one hope that belongs to your call. And what is that one hope? To our call, we're called to one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Very quickly, what does one Lord mean? One Lord mean, the Greek word is kurios in Scripture. It means that Jesus is Lord. It means that Jesus is King. It means that Jesus is Master. It means that Jesus is CEO. It means that Jesus is the boss man of your life. It means that Jesus is in control. It means that Jesus called the shots. That's why as our little girl, as she was receiving Jesus just 2 weeks ago into her life, making him her Lord and Savior at 4 years old, a question I had to ask her was, not just, Brooklyn, do you want to ask Jesus in your heart? But Brooklyn, do you believe that he died? He rose from the dead. And if Jesus asked you to do something you didn't want to do, would you do it? I was helping her to understand the lordship of Jesus, and she said, yeah, Dad, I would do it. And she asked Jesus to become the Lord of her life. That's what salvation is, that Jesus is Lord. Jesus does not deserve to just be a part of our life. What lordship means is Jesus becomes our life. Can I get an amen? And it comes through one faith. Today in our world, in our country, even in our community, there are so many different faiths. And we respect people because of human dignity. They're created in the image of God. We respect people and we love people of different faiths. But the Bible says there is only one faith. Amen? And what is that one faith? That one faith is not just to believe something generically about God. That one faith is not just to believe that God exists. That one faith is not just to believe that God is there. But the Bible says that one faith is to believe that Jesus is God. That Jesus died for our sin. That Jesus rose from the dead. That Jesus is coming back. That Jesus is Lord. The Bible says there is one faith. In fact, I've heard it said, and I love the quote, if Jesus isn't Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. If Jesus is not Lord of our all, then he's not our Lord at all. If I can make it more personal, if Jesus is not Lord of my all, he's not my Lord at all. If Jesus is not Lord of your all, he's not your Lord at all. We believe that Jesus is Lord. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15, it says, and Jesus died for all. He died for everyone. Why? So that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him, Jesus, who for their sake, who for your sake, died and was raised. Why did Jesus die? Why did he raise from the dead? So that we might live for him and no longer live for ourselves. In other words, if you believe in Jesus, you know it by the way that you are living for Jesus. If you believe in Jesus, you will be living for Jesus. He says one Lord, one faith. He says one baptism. He says there's one baptism. What does that mean? Because there are so many different modes, so many different ways of baptism today, even in all of religions, but even within Christianity, there can be a lot of different baptisms. If I can just be pastorally, lovingly honest with you, the Bible says there is one baptism. So please hear my heart in this. When the Bible talks about baptism, we see all throughout Scripture, and you can look it up and you can do your own study. And don't let anybody just reason you out of this. Go do your own study in the Word of God. There is only one baptism, and the Bible shows it all throughout Scripture. And the baptism is when someone goes under the water and they come out of the water. Why? Because that baptism is symbolizing that Jesus has died and Jesus has risen from the dead. Please look it up. There are no sprinkle baptisms in the whole Bible. There are no infant baptisms in the whole Bible. There's no baptism in the Bible that you get baptized before you're saved. There's no baptism in the Bible that you get baptized in order to be saved. There is one baptism in the Bible, and the Scriptures say, and you can look it up for yourself, that once you are saved, the Bible says, believe and be baptized. So we believe in Jesus Christ, and because of our faith, because of our salvation, our baptism is a symbol of our belief, a symbol of our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and it's a profession of faith to other people who are watching, who is the church. Can I get an amen? So I want to pastorally ask you, have you been biblically baptized? Have you been biblically baptized? Because, not because I want anything for myself or for our church, because I want to make sure that you are walking in obedience with the Lord Jesus Christ, with your life, with your relationship with him. And I would love, man, I pray this year, my prayer is that we get to see 50 people baptized this year. I want to encourage you, I want to invite you to pray that with me. I would love for us as a church to see 50 people baptized this year. And people have a lot of fears with baptism. Some people are afraid of water. And if I can just encourage you for a moment, to my knowledge, we have never drowned one person baptizing them at First Baptist Church Powder Springs. I'm pretty sure we're like 100% on that one. It is going pretty well, and I'm not about to change that, just so you know. I'm not going to hold you down longer if you're a greater sinner than anybody. It's just down and up. That's all it is. That's all it is. Some people are afraid of crowds. I want you to know you're not alone. We're all afraid of crowds in some way. Some people, they're afraid because maybe they feel too old. Man, I got just a couple of years ago, I got to baptize a lady in her 90s that could not move. I was one of the people that got to pick her up as a sheet as we dipped her into her own garden tub and we baptized her right there in the Lord Jesus. You're never too old. Hear me. You're never too young. The point of baptism is not age. The point of baptism, hear me, is faith. If your faith is in Jesus Christ, then I want to encourage you by the Word of God that you have been baptized on the right side of your salvation, since your salvation, because he says there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. He says there's one call. We're called to follow Jesus. There's one hope. You ever noticed in our English language, hope means wish? Like, I hope this is going to happen, but in biblical language, hope means I have certainty. It's a completely different word. When we hope in Jesus, not, oh, I hope Jesus is going to come back. No, Jesus is going to come back. The Bible says that Jesus works out everything for your good who are called according to his purpose. Guess what? That's not a hope. I hope this trial is going to work out for me. No, it's a hope. It's a certainty. You can have faith in that. It's the call that you are called to is our hope in Jesus Christ. And number three, and I'm done. Number one, be filled with the Spirit of God. Number two, be following Jesus as your Lord. Number three, that everything would be for the glory of God our Father. That everything would be for the glory of God our Father. We are not doing church for the name of our church. Can I get an amen? We are not doing church to become a great church or a big church or a whatever church. We are doing church so that we can glorify God our Father. That's why we feel called. We believe that we're called to reach people. That's why it is your opportunity to share people about what God is doing here and what God can do in their life as well. It says in verse 6 that there is one God. Aren't you thankful that other religions aren't true? Aren't you thankful that Christianity is the only one true faith? Aren't you thankful that Hinduism is not true? That we don't have to believe or the guesswork or the fear, the doubt of millions, hundreds of millions of different gods, and we're not sure who we're dealing with, that we get to, hear me, we get to know God. He says there's one God. There's one Father of all who is over all and through all and in all. Deuteronomy 6:4 says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. The Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all of your might." The Lord our God is one. I would imagine there are some people that are thinking that Christian math is messed up math. That we believe in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, three persons, but one God. How does 1 + 1 + 1 = 1? It doesn't. 1 × 1 × 1 × 1 = 1. We believe in one God who is three persons, the Trinity, and here's what our God says about himself in your life. It says that he is your Father. He's your Father. I love being a dad. I love picking up my kids. I love throwing them across the room on the bed. I love just roughhousing. I love tickling. I love playing with them. And man, I love my kids. I can't wait for our baby girl to be born here, Lord willing, in May. But even when I'm upset, even when I need to discipline my kids, I always hug them first. Before I discipline them, and then I hug them at the end. Because they need to know that I love them more than anything. And that's what God wants you to know. Hear me. I don't know what guilt or shame that you might live with, like guilt and shame from the power of the evil one that I can live with. But hear me. Your Father, God, if you have a relationship with him through Jesus, he loves you first. Even when we have a difficult conversation with someone, we want to make sure that we always share our love for them first, that this truth comes out of our love. Even as I said a minute ago, discipline comes out of our love. But as a dad, I can't just walk around in Walmart and pick up somebody else's kid and start hugging them and kissing them. That's how I go to jail, right? I mean, that's weird. Nobody wants to see that kind of stalker, right, going around. Or if I pick up a kid that's acting up in Walmart and I pick him up and I discipline him, that's a great way to go to jail. I'm not going to do that. Why? It's not my kid. I need you to see here in this passage, it says one God. He is one God and he is one Father of all. But here is what Paul is saying that the English language doesn't translate very well. It means this: one God and Father of you all. He's talking about the church. Because John 1:12 says that we have been given the right to become the children of God when we place our faith in Jesus. God is not Father over the world. He is Father over Christians. He's Father over you. He's Father over me as we believe in Jesus. He is over all of you. He is through all of you. And he is in all of you. God is a Father and he loves us. And in closing, I think about the verse that Jesus told his disciples. He said, "There are still sheep out there that are supposed to be of my fold, And I need you, and I need you to go out and share me with them and bring them back so they can be saved, so they can be my sheep, they could be of my fold or my flock as well. The same is true for the Father. God the Father says there are children, there are people out there that are meant to be, I want them as my children. God loves all people. And he says, I want you to go out and I want you to share my love with them, the good news of Jesus with them, so that they can be my children too. Because can you imagine the heart of a father that doesn't have all of his children? I was on a beach trip years ago. It was a student ministry trip, and we probably had about 80 or 90 teenagers there and all the adults and all that kind of stuff. And we were all at the beach, and one of our associate pastors was there. His name's Jim, and Jim and his wife had their three kids there, and one of them was a little four-year-old by the name of Luke. We're all at the beach, and it was time to go back to our beach house. And so we got all the, about 80, 900 people together, and all right, let's all go back to the beach house. And we get back to the beach house, and everybody was there. We crossed the road. We left the beach. It was about 100 yards back, and we get back to the beach house, and Luke is nowhere to be found. The dad looked at the mom. I thought he was with you. The mom looked at the dad. I thought he was with you. We had left Luke at the beach. So we all gathered everybody together real quick, and we all went back to the beach, and we all just scattered, dispersed. Everyone running around desperately looking for Luke. We all met back at the beach house an hour later, and everybody came back, and nobody found him. There are no words how that mom and dad felt in that moment. So we did all we knew to do is just hit our knees and we just prayed. Police car rolled up. Door opens. Little Luke jumps out of the car. Runs into the beach house. Runs into his father's arms. Runs into his mom's arms. And they got their son back. I literally cannot imagine how they felt in that moment. Maybe you can. It would be like the father of the prodigal son who gained his son back. But all of those stories are designed for us to be able to understand just for a moment in time what it feels like for God to be Father and how he feels when someone becomes his child. And it's our opportunity. And here's the beautiful thing about it. It's our opportunity, but it's not our power. Because all we can do is share. All we can do is tell the story. All we can do is talk about Jesus. All we can do is invite them. But it's the Holy Spirit that must have the power in their life in order to bring them to Jesus, to become a child of God. And so as a church, as we are here as one team, I just want to encourage you, we are here for those not yet here. And I just see empty seats. But as we look around, we're not meant to just see empty seats. We're to see these empty seats with vision. And who do you know? Who do you come across? Who do you pray for? Who do you desire to be a part of these seats, to be a part of this movement of what God is doing here called the church, that God wants to be able to change the world with the good news that he has in his son, Jesus. With every head bowed and every eye closed this morning, I just want to encourage you just to focus your mind and to fix your eyes on Jesus in this moment right here. And I just want you to respond however it is that God is calling you to respond. Maybe God has spoken to you this morning just about loving his church all the more. Maybe God has spoken to you in your heart, in your life this morning. Maybe it could be about being baptized. Maybe this morning it could be about being saved and giving your life over to him. Maybe it could be about someone that he has in your life that you need to talk to him. You need to invite him what Jesus wants to do in their life and what Jesus wants to do in them here. then maybe you need to give your life to the Lord first this morning. And as I love to say every Sunday, I can't pray this prayer for you. I can't save you. But you could pray this prayer from your own heart, your own words. You could pray it to God, and he promises that he will make you his child if that's you today. Today is your day of salvation. You could pray something like this. You could just, from your own heart and your own words, you can say, "Dear Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I need you. I'm desperate for you. Jesus, I'm calling on you. Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross for my sin. And so, Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sin. And I don't want to follow my sin anymore, live for my sin anymore. Jesus, I want to turn, and I want to turn, and I want to give my life to you. I want to live my life for you, Jesus. I call on you to be the Lord of my life. Be my Lord, be my master, be my God, be my Savior, be my everything, Jesus." And you might need to tell him this morning, "Jesus, I believe that you rose from the dead. You're alive, and I want you to be alive in me." Because the Bible promises if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe with your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, can you put your hands together this morning for anybody that gave their life to Jesus? We're so thankful. As heaven rejoices, the Bible says that heaven rejoices every time a sinner repents and gives their life to him. I just want to encourage you right now. We just want to stand up. Let's all stand together, and we're going to sing one last worship song, and maybe you need to just take a next step card, and you just need to indicate anything that God is doing in your life, and we'll give you an opportunity after the service of where to take this. Let's sing. Let's lift the name of Jesus up right now.
Into the void, the breath that brought the dust to life and sang the stars to fall. The darkness fears your voice that drove me back before. Thank you. Lift up a shout of praise to the Lord right now. Listen, if we haven't met, my name is Will Burke. I've been on staff here for about a month now. It's been really awesome. I've enjoyed making funny videos and just like making this just the best experience that we can just to encounter Christ. Something that myself, Grayson, our production director, who's not here today, and Jenny Highsmith, who's our creative director, something that we've been super, super excited about over the last few weeks. As we've been kind of making changes and trying to make this the best that we can for all of y'all and for us and making it a fun experience for us to serve and worship with y'all, we're like, we desperately need some hands, y'all. So if you play guitar, sing, play bass, an instrument, you play an orchestral instrument, you want to serve on Mark's team, or you're a graphic designer, photographer, videographer, you like to design spaces, you're a decorator, or you just want to serve and run a camera like these guys behind you, turn around and wave at them. Hi, y'all. How we doing? Anyways, if you're interested in any of that, we have some sign-up sheets. It's just your name and some contact information to kind of get you plugged in. But we'd love to talk to you, so I'm just going to hang out right here for like 15, 20 minutes, something like that. But yeah, we'd love to have you. So that's mine.
Love it. Give our worship team a big round of applause. What God they do. Will's got on his new shirt. I've got on my new shirt of our First Baptist Church, Powder Springs. So y'all make sure and go by the product table and get you something while supplies last, okay? While supplies last. I just want to remind you, next Sunday is our church conference. Our church conference is going to be next Sunday evening. And so I want to invite you to be a part of that. It's for members. It's just church family, talk, a conversation. And so you know everything that's coming up in our church, everything that's going on, and any votes that we have, we invite you to be a part of that next Sunday evening. Remember about this Wednesday, we have our meal together, our church meal at 5:15, serving Chick-fil-A, just $6 a piece. And we have groups all around our facility. Kids groups and student groups and all of our adult groups that we would love for you to be a part of. You can jump in at any time, join in at any time. We would love for you to be a part of the community that God is doing every Wednesday. I already can't wait to see you next Sunday. So First Baptist Church, Powder Springs, I hope you have your best Super Bowl Sunday ever. We'll see you soon.